Hi, this is Dr. Graves from the CSUN Geography Department. This is a tutorial for a geography course in which you will be asked to log on to the virtual software lab, also known as MyCSUN Software, in order to complete a basic introduction to GIS and weather mapping. This is the lab that this is associated with. It also has components on Canvas that will look somewhat like this. And this is will take you step by step through in a video tutorial fashion to complete the lab. This tutorial assumes that you have already installed the Citrix receiver successfully and that you have completed the background to this particular component of the lab by watching the video from Geospatial Revolution. So here we are again. Click on MyCSUN Software. Click on Log In to MyCSUN Software. Your username and password should appear. Occasionally, there'll be a dialog box here questioning whether you have the receiver installed. If you already do, sometimes it still thinks that you don't, and you can go ahead and log in over top of that. Here are the options for the categories of software. You may not see the same ones. Note that you should have access to Microsoft Office Suite, including Microsoft Excel, which you will use in this class at some point, but we're going to use ArcGIS, so click once on that and make sure that you are using ArcMap, not ArcGlobe or Catalog or ArcScene. ArcMap 106. So click once. Sometimes takes a minute or two to load, sometimes faster. When this window appears, click Cancel, click File Open. When this dialog box appears, click This PC. Scroll down until you see the Geog Share H drive. Double click on the Geog 105 folder if you're in that course. Perhaps you're in Geog 102, you may want to use that one. This is called USA. Double click and click on Introduction 105. Double click or click and click open. May take a minute to load. One of the first things you can do is to click File, Save As, and save to your desktop. Now, of course, this isn't on your desktop on your machine, but on your virtual computer that you may want to think of as in the library or in the basement of the library here on campus. You won't be able to find it on your desktop on your machine, but on this virtual machine. So you may want to call it Introduction 105 and then call it something like Steve, which is my name, but you would want to call it your own name or something like that. So what is the first thing that you want to do? This lab is designed to familiarize you with the features of this software. So over here on the left is the table of contents window. Notice that there are multiple map layers. Each of these words here represent a map layer, and you can turn the map layers on and off by clicking in the checkbox to the left of the words associated with that layer. So I can turn off the cities layer and they disappear. I can turn them back on. I can turn off the solar DNI layer. I can add or turn on the temperature layer down here. So experiment a bit with that. You are also going to learn how to use the various tools for zooming in and out. So if I wanted to zoom in to a particular location, so I can click on the zoom in, and we can zoom in just to Colorado by clicking and dragging a box around Colorado, and I have zoomed in. I can return to the previous extent by clicking on this left arrow, or I can zoom out to the full extent by clicking on the globe icon. So zoom out to the full extent, and that returns us. There are other zooming in and zooming out tools. The pan tool allows you to grab the entire map and move it around. And then the other tool that you are going to use is the information button, known as Identify here. So on Identify, you can click on a city. I'm going to click on Oklahoma City here. Oh, I clicked on Tulsa. And information regarding Tulsa popped up, including the population in 2000, the size of the city in terms of the area, the name of the city, etc. If we zoom in very closely, I'm going to zoom into a corner of New Mexico, and we see these little grid squares. I can also click on information regarding these, and I click and a little window popped up. There's not as much information about this cell. It just says that there are 7.6 kilowatt hours of energy per square mile per day on that grid square. If I turn off this layer and click on New Mexico, because it's now the topmost layer, I get information about Mexico. There are two types of maps layered together in this entire map project. One is a raster map. If I click off the cities and the US border map, you see all of these grid squares. Easiest to see here in Texas. And each of these represents roughly a 10 square kilometer patch of ground. And on those patches of ground is a value associated with, in this case, the amount of solar energy reaching the ground. But if we turn on the layer of temperature, it gives you the average annual temperature layer. The precipitation layer is also in raster format. So there are little grid squares that contain just one piece of information. Here's the DEM, which is a digital elevation model, which is associated with, elevation, mountains and valleys. We'll turn those off. At the bottom is the U.S. states map. The U.S. states map, which I just turned gray to make it easier to see, is a vector map, and the vector includes sort of a jigsaw puzzle that is large, and it includes loads of data. The vector maps include the city map and the U.S. states map and the borders map, which is at the top. Those are the three vector maps. I think you have to answer a couple of questions about vector and raster, so you may want to pause. I'm going to zoom to the full extent and turn the solar DNI map back on. The solar DNI map is roughly a map of the amount of solar energy or sun energy that's striking the ground, and you notice that out here in the desert southwest, the solar energy is more intense. And you are going to be asked to zoom in on a few cities. Let's try one here. Let's zoom in on Memphis or Nashville, Tennessee. There's Nashville. I'm going to use the Identify button to bring up some information about Nashville. Notice that I was very careful to click directly on the point or the dot on the map. And so the population of Nashville is 545,000 some people. And if we want to know the solar DNI for Nashville, I click very close to it and I have a value of 4.07. If I turn on the temperature layer and turn off the solar layer, I can do the same thing and find the average yearly temperature in Celsius, which is 14.7. You're going to be asked to do several of these kind of questions. So hopefully you understand how to do it. You may want to pause the video and answer a couple of questions in your learning management system. The last component of this lab is to ask you to think critically about the relationships that you notice between solar energy and temperature. Notice that they don't match very evenly because some of the areas in the southeastern United States that don't receive a great deal of direct solar energy or much less than what you find in the deserts, nevertheless, have higher average temperatures or as high average temperatures. So what are the other factors associated with temperature? What does precipitation or cloud cover and humidity have to do with that? Is there a relationship between the amount of rain that falls and the temperature and the solar energy that reaches the ground? What's the relationship between temperature, precipitation, and elevation? Does elevation affect temperature? Does elevation affect DNI at all? You are asked to think critically about that and make some preliminary hypotheses about the relationship between these four variables. Some of them are causal variables and some are effect variables, meaning that they are dependent upon the other variables. Some of the variables are independent, meaning that nothing affects them, but they affect the other elements. So think about those and answer the last handful of questions. And then later in the semester, we will try to construct more effective hypotheses and run some statistical analyses on these variables in order to make some more concrete conclusions about the relationship of the three variables. That's the end of this video tutorial. I hope it was useful to you.